वेलकम बैक COL 774 मशीन लर्निंग। एंड टुडे इज ट्यूजडे April 28, 2020। लास्ट क्लास we were looking at PCA, principal component analysis, right? And remember we started with the problem of maximizing the total variance of the projected data, and then eventually, right, following some mathematical steps, we showed that right, that the problem reduced to finding the principal components or the eigenvectors, right? If you are looking for k components, then top k eigenvectors of this matrix, of this X transpose X matrix, where X was simply the design matrix or the data matrix, right, which is simply the where each row represents the set of examples. Right, and when we say top k, this essentially corresponded to the vectors, eigenvectors, which have the highest eigen values, right? And also recall that because this is a symmetric and positive semi-definite matrix, right? So all the eigen values are real and non-negative. Okay. And let's move on to the next slide. We looked at two different ways of, you know, finding the eigen vectors and eigen values of X transpose X. First one was eigenvalue composition, right, which sort of wrote this, which expressed this matrix as a product of three matrices Q, this matrix lambda, and then Q inverse or Q transpose, where this was a diagonal matrix. Where the entries correspond to the eigenvalues of X transpose X, and this Q, the columns of Q were eigenvectors of X transpose X, right? So this was the eigenvalue decomposition of this X transpose X matrix, right? And recall that X transpose X was nothing but the empirical covariance matrix, given that the mean in each dimension has been normalized to be zero. So this was the first approach. This took order n cube time, right? Remember, this was an n cross n matrix, right? Then we proposed a sort of a better approach, which is based on SVD, called singular value decomposition of matrix X, right? So given any matrix X, right, let's say which is M by N, we said that X can be decomposed as product of three matrices. We wrote them as U, D, V transpose, right? And pictorially, this U was an n by n matrix. Okay, this D was sort of a diagonal matrix in the sense that all the entries, so let me write it properly. In fact, there is a small correction here. This U is M by M, right? And this D is M by N, right? Where all, assuming N to be greater than M, greater than equal to M, right, which is the case for many problems. For example, the image classification problem, right, where you have a, let's say, an image. Each image could be up to a million pixels, but you may have only a few thousand examples or 10,000 examples, right? So in many problems, the dimension of the feature space may be much larger than number of examples, and which is the case we are dealing here. So in that case, right, this M is smaller than N, right? So all the entries on this sort of diagonal are non-zero. All these entries are zero, and all these entries are also zero, right? So all the remaining N minus M entries are zero. And then the case for M greater than N equal to N is sort of symmetric, right? So the same decomposition holds, but the right? So this D is sort of transposed. Okay, and then we have a V matrix or V transpose matrix, right? So this is U, this is D, and then there is a V matrix, right, which is N by N or V transpose matrix, right? And we said that for our purpose, columns of V, right? So we said that columns of matrix V correspond to eigen vectors of X transpose X, right? So this matrix here is V transpose, right? And the columns of V are eigenvectors of X transpose X. So which will mean that because this is V transpose, right? So we'll look at sort of the rows here of this V transpose matrix, which are essentially columns of V, and they will be our eigenvectors, right? So they will be of this form, right? And each one will correspond to an entry on this diagonal matrix. Okay, so we did that in the last class, and finally we said that this, right, without a sort of a proof, we said that this is order min m square n and n square m, right? So this entire operation can be done in this much time complexity, which is order of minimum of m square n and n square m, right? And it shows that it is sort of symmetric, right? So it can handle both cases efficiently, where n is greater than equal to m or m is greater than equal to n, right? And in fact, in the software, right, when you actually implement it, right, there is a very simple command, right, which will be just calling SVD of this X matrix, and which will essentially give you this decomposition from which you can read off the eigenvalues and the corresponding eigenvectors. And what you're really interested in is the eigenvectors corresponding to top K eigenvalues, where the elements of this diagonal matrix, in fact, I should have mentioned that here, right, the elements of this diagonal matrix are nothing but square root of the eigen values of X transpose X, right? So in particular, we have, if there is an element D, let me write it as L, so DLL square is equal to lambda L, right? So where lambda L is the eigen value of X transpose X, right? So this was the result that we stated also in the last class. Okay, and this is homework for you to show that, you know, given that supposing there is a matrix M, which is let's say M by N, which can be decomposed using SVD in the form of U, D, V transpose, where U, D, V are as described on the previous slide, and remember U, V are ortho normal matrices. Right, which means that the columns of both U and V are perpendicular to each other, right? So if I take the dot product of any two different columns of U or columns of V, the dot product will be zero, and also the norm is one. And similarly for the rows of U and V, right? So these are called orthonormal matrices, and ND is sort of the way we have defined it earlier. On the previous slide, right, it's sort of a diagonal matrix, and remaining n minus m entries to be zero, assuming n is greater than m, right, exactly the way we have described on the previous slide. Then your homework is to show that in fact, right, if I compute x transpose x, right, which will be u d v transpose U D V transpose, right, which will become V D transpose U D V transpose, right, and this is a property of orthonormal matrices that this will be identity, right? So this will become V D transpose D V transpose, and then, right, I have almost solved this, but you have to show that this particular sort of form can be written such that, right, if I right from this you can derive the fact that the eigenvalues, right, so columns of V, right, this is V, are eigen vectors of X transpose X, and the diagonal entries of D transpose D are eigen values of X transpose X. Note that D transpose D now will be n by n, and right, the entries of D transpose D will essentially be square of the diagonal elements of D, right, and many of them will be zero because of the zero sitting on the right in the right side of the D matrix, right? So this is something that you should do as a homework and actually prove this result. It should not be too difficult. So I will leave it here and move on to eigenfaces, which is sort of an application of PCA to the specific task of you know, finding these components for image related tasks, especially, you know, face recognition, right, projecting your data onto lower dimensional subspace using PCA, and then doing classification using this projected space or projected dimensions. Okay, so let me give you a very brief background on this idea of eigenfaces, and then I will show you some actual example of its application, right, from a paper. Right, so this is eigenfaces. Right, so the idea is as follows, that suppose you have a bunch of images, right, let's say you know, xi I equal to 1 to m, right, and each xi is an image, right, so this could be some let's say n by n sized image, right, and you are trying to recognize some faces in these images, right? In fact, right, this is this face is what you are really interested in, right? And this bottom part may not be really relevant. So given this, what we do is, right, and this could be very high dimensional, right? So note that here the dimensionality is n square, right? So if n is, let's say, sort of 1000, right? So the actual dimensionality is 1 million, right? Which is really huge, right? So what we do is we project this data of m images onto a lower dimensional subspace, which is, let's say, u1 up to uk, right? And this k typically could be 50, for example, right? And each of these ul's, right, again belong to this r n cross n space, right, or r n square space, if you will, right? This is right, each of these ul's can be represented as a vector in the original space, which is n by n space, right? And then what we do is we project, you know, each xi onto the space u1 up to uk, right, to get a vector zi, right? And this in the u1 to uk space, right, this zi vector is just a k dimensional vector, right? Right, that's the whole idea of dimensionality reduction, right? So we sort of project each xi onto this zi, right? And this zi is, remember, zi l is nothing but xi transpose ul, right? And these zi l, right, there are k of them, are essentially your projections along each of these k dimensions, right? So what we have done is that given this subspace u1 to uk, right, we can represent our images in terms of these u1 to uk vectors, right, in using only k such components, right? And what you really project on, right, these u1 to uk, which again can be thought of as faces, quote unquote, right, because they can be represented in the original sort of pixel space, and these are called eigen faces, right? And as we can see, right, these eigen faces are nothing but sort of eigen vectors corresponding to two highest eigen values for our data, right, which is essentially the x transpose x matrix, right? So this is the basic idea, and let us look at in the next slide what these eigen faces and these sort of projections are. So let's look at an example of this technique, application of this technique called eigen faces, right? This is one of the early works by Turk and Pentland from MIT. This was published in Journal of Cognitive Neuroscience back in 1991, which is almost 3 decades, but I guess this is still quite illustrative of how this idea of eigen faces can be used, right? It was one of the first application, right, of this idea of eigen faces for face recognition, right? So there is some earlier work which by Sirovich and Kirby a few years earlier, right, which used the technique of PCA to project a set of faces onto a lower dimensional subspace, right? But I guess these were the first ones to really use this for the task of face recognition, right, to actually use the projected sort of components to as features and classify new faces into one of the categories, right? So what they're doing, it's a very, very small database, 16 people, and they've taken 16 images of these people, right? And you want to project them lower onto a lower dimensional subspace. In this case, they project them on 7-dimensional subspace. We'll look at that soon, but let us also look at, right, so this is the image on the left, right? Both the images have been taken from the original paper by the authors, Turk and Pentland, right? On the left, you see these 16 faces, and on the right, you see sort of an average face, right? Remember, right, we subtract the mean before we do PCA, so this is sort of the mean or the average face of these 16 faces. Okay, so in this slide on the left side, we see what we refer to as eigenfaces, right? So here, right, we have projected our data onto this seven-dimensional lower subspace, right? And each component here, right, U1 to UK, right, where K is 7, has been represented in the original space, right? Remember that each of these ULs, right, which is our principal component, right, it can also be represented in the original space as sort of n-dimensional vector. In this case, you know, these are images of size 128 by 128, right? So what we are doing is we have computed these principal seven principal components, right, U1 to UK, and then represented each of these components in the original image space, which is 128 by 128, right? So it will still look like an image, right? Right, there are seven of them, right? And you can see that each of these images, right, on the left are capturing different sort of facets or different dimensions of what a face might look like, right? It's in the right, for example, they may be capturing different contours or different edges and so on and so forth, right? And your ZI, right, which is sort of your projection of XI onto these seven components, will now be a sort of a linear combination of these seven eigenfaces, right? So in the projected space, each ZI can be represented in terms of the seven size vector, which are essentially the coefficients of these U1 to UK, the eigenfaces, right? And on the right side, what you see here is a particular face from the original database, right? One of the 16 faces. And then projected onto this this new subspace, right? And then again, the projected image is represented here, or sort of constructed here in the right image, and in the right side image, the right one is the projected image. And you can see that this is, you know, pretty close to the original face, right? You can easily recognize by naked eye, right? Which means that there is very little loss of information when you project the data from this very, very high dimensional, which is, you know, about 16,000 pixels, to this seven dimensional space, which is spanned by these eigenfaces, right? So this is the basic idea of the PCA technique, right, applied to face recognition. And again, both these set of images are taken from the original paper by Turk and Pentland, which was published back in 1991. And finally, a few more images of projections, right? So on the left, what we see here is sort of the images from the original data set, and right, in the first two cases in each row, right? And on the right side, we see the projections, and you can see they are, you know, at least at this resolution level, they are pretty much indistinguishable, right? So which is great that, you know, there is very little loss of information, right? And again, I'll refer you to the original paper to read sort of more details. But what is interesting is that the last image, right? So what, right, they have done, the authors have done an interesting experiment, right? They have taken an image which is not really a face, right? So they have, right, they have taken an image of a flower, right? And you would, right, they would like to see what happens when you project onto the subspace, right, which is essentially, you know, spanning or representing your facial images, right? So as you can see, that because it is a much, much lower dimensional subspace, which is primarily constructed to represent these faces, when you try to project an image of an object which is not a face, right, in this case a flower, right, you get sort of this weird looking image. And I guess, again, refer to the paper for sort of a better resolution of this. But you know, what it is trying to do is project this flower image onto this facial sort of representation, trying to represent the flower, right, in terms of a face. Because in some sense, in the projected space, what you know is only to represent a face, right? So you take a flower and sort of transform into the closest sort of facial representation, and you get this weird looking sort of image on the bottom right, right? And again, refer to the paper for more details. And both, right, all these images, right, on this slide are again taken from the original paper by Turk and Pentland. Okay, so just to sort of summarize what we have done here in the sort of last few slides is use this technique of eigen faces, or rather applied PCA for the problem of recognizing faces, and these components, right, principal components for this problem are called eigenfaces, right? So essentially what you do is that you take this data set of all your images, right, which in the previous case were just 16 images, right? You do PCA over the X transpose X matrix, right, or using the X transpose X matrix, right? You do SVD over X and then compute the eigenvectors, right, top 7 eigenvectors in the previous case of this X transpose X matrix, which will give you these eigenfaces, right? And then you can project your data onto these eigenfaces, and we saw that there was very little loss of information. But what is also more interesting, and in fact the paper that we just looked at does that, right, then they use this sort of projected space, right, which is just 7-dimensional, right, to actually, you know, do the task of face recognition, right? So instead of using your sort of classification task, instead of using the original set of features, right, for classification, you use now this representation in the new sort of 7-dimensional space to recognize faces, right? And you can look at the paper for more details about the specific accuracy and so forth, right? And I should mention that, you know, this was a very, very early example, right, almost 30 years back of this this particular technique, but right, typically you would use maybe a larger kind of space with more computational power now, maybe like 50 or 60 or maybe even 100 dimensional sort of representation, which would give you a fairly okay or reasonable classification accuracy, right? And in general, these projected features in this lower dimensional subspace could be used for any further downstream classification task, right? So this sort of ends our discussion on PCA, right, or principal component analysis. Right, and that also sort of wraps up our discussion of unsupervised learning, right, and now we'll go into the next topic, which is sort of the last topic of this course, and which is on learning theory. Learning theory, right? Remember that, you know, till now, right, which is, you know, most of this class, right, we have been really concerned about, you know, two kinds of problems, right? One is the set of supervised learning problems, right, where we are given these set of examples, xi, yi, xi are the set of features, right, m such examples, and yi's are the labels, and we want to really use them for classification, right? So a new data point comes, which is your x, and then you want to really figure out, you know, the best possible y, right, the class label for that x, right? So this is sort of supervised learning, and we have looked at a bunch of techniques right for the supervised learning. The second thing that we have sort of done in the later part of the course is unsupervised learning problem, right, where we said that we don't have these yi's, right, these yi's are missing, right, so only thing that we have here is xi's, right, there is no sort of yi here, right, and then we would like to really figure out some underlying pattern in the data, right? So for example, it could be clusters or estimating density and so on and so forth, right? And these, right, we sort of talked about various algorithms, both in the case of supervised learning as well as unsupervised learning, right? They are useful from a utility point of view also, that you can apply them on real data to get some useful to solve some important problems, right? Right, either it is classification or clustering and many such applications, right? But what we have really not talked about is sort of the topic of today's class and maybe next couple of classes, right? Which is the last topic here, is essentially the idea of learnability. Right, and the question that we are trying to answer here is simply as follows, and note that we will do this in the context of supervised learning. Right, so the ideas that we'll develop here will be in the context of primarily supervised learning. I am not really sure if you could really extend them to unsupervised case, but maybe I have to go back and check out, right? But I think in this class we will primarily look at this learnability question in the case of supervised learning, right? And in particular we'll focus on very simple examples of classification. But let me start with some intuition, which is sort of more general, right? So given recall the problem of linear regression, right? And we were given some bunch of data, right, in this space, and our right, so given set of examples, right, your class level is on the y-axis and your feature is on the x-axis, right? This is a simple sort of demonstration of a one-dimensional problem, and we are trying to really fit a line on this, right? And we optimize some some metric of error j theta, which was yi minus h theta xi, right, whole square over sum over all x samples, I equal to 1 to m, right? So this was our error metric, and we sort of optimized this, right? H theta was representing a line, right, in this case, or in general a sort of linear hypothesis, right? It was a linear hypothesis, right? It was theta transpose x in general, but in this case it turns out to be line in the two dimensional, or I guess just with one feature, right? So we were trying to optimize this j theta, and we got this line, right? And what was the right, how did we really use this? We said, okay, given this line, right, which was obtained by minimizing this j theta, right, and we said, okay, this is our sort of a model, right, that we learned, right? We obtained our optimal parameters, right, by doing argmax over theta of, right, and we obtained some parameters, let's say theta star, and we said that this is the model of the world, right? So now what happens is that, right, suppose a new point comes in, right? So suppose a new point comes in here, right, x, right, and we would like to say, what is my corresponding y for this x, right? So we simply said, right, well the x would be here, right, in some sense, right? So the new point here will be here on this. And then we said, okay, what is my prediction for this x? Is essentially, you just project this back on the line, right? So or in particular, right, if your theta star is sort of your optimal parameters, then you simply do h theta star of x, right? So this is your y hat, right? And we said that, this is our prediction, right? Now there are some fundamental questions here, right, that we really need to answer, which is, what makes us believe that this is a good model of the world, right? So you minimized some error on the training data, right? You said, okay, you optimized this yi minus h theta xi sort of whole squared on the training data, right? So you said, okay, my line fits well on the training data, fine, right? And given among all the linear sort of hypothesis, right, among all the lines, right, or in general, sort of your linear hypothesis, right, in sort of RN in general, right, this is sort of the best line, which minimizes this squared error over training data. But the fundamental question is, why should it really generalize to a new point, right? Why should right you believe that a new point which comes in, right, in fact, if you just project this back onto this learned line, that will be your sort of y hat, right? What makes you believe, right, that or why can't it be the case that maybe for this new x, right, your actual y was right here, right? Right, it could as well be the case that this was your actual y and this was sort of your y hat, and in which case the error would be very high, right? But there is something fundamental that makes you believe that right, your line is sort of a good prediction of what is going to happen in future, right? And there are few assumptions that we make here, and we'll talk about those assumptions very soon, and that is the whole goal of learnability, to sort of maybe quantify those assumptions, right, and say how good of a predictor is your error over the training set, right? So if you do well on the training set, right, how sorry, how confidently can you say that you will also do well on the test set? And there are some underlying assumptions that we make. For example, one of them makes the assumption that the data, right, your training data and test data come from the same underlying distribution. And it also makes certain other assumptions about the goodness of your hypothesis space. You know, for example, linear classifier in this case, or linear sort of regressors in this case, are a good hypothesis to represent your underlying model, right? So in this set of lectures, we'll try to formalize this notion of learnability, right, which also connects with this important question of generalizability. Right, that you know, how well can your learned hypothesis generalize, right, which is really what you're interested in, you know, going from the training error, minimizing of the training error, to minimizing really what you care about is error over unseen examples, which is represented, or which we essentially use the notion of generalizability, representing the amount of error on future examples coming from the same distribution. Right. So this is the topic of you know, this class and next couple of classes. So let us look at some of the assumptions, right, that we are sort of implicitly making in this entire process of you know, generalizing from learning a hypothesis over the training data and then generalizing it to the unseen data. Right. So the first sort of assumption that we make here. Is that, right, suppose these are our training examples, right, xi I equal to 1 to m, right, and each xi, right, yi is coming from some distribution, right, some underlying distribution. This we'll just write it as distribution, right, and for at least for the setting that we're dealing in, we'll assume that they are iid, right, so they are identically independently distributed, right. According to some underlying distribution, right, and we looked at various distributions in the previous set of lectures, right, where from which these xi yi could come from. But what is important here is that, you know, that really your test data, right, which is xy, right, also comes from the same distribution. Right, so this is a very, very important assumption, right, about the fact that, you know, each example, right, that xi yi is right, these are identically and independently distributed, and they are coming from some distribution, right, but not only that, all your test examples, right, future examples will also come from the same distribution, right, and this is a very, very important and fundamental assumption that we sort of have made implicitly, right, to actually, right, arrive at the result or to be able to ensure good prediction, right? If your future data does not come from the same distribution, then you may not have much hope of doing well on the future data, right? I should mention that, you know, many problems today, right, may not be able to make this sort of identically independently distributed assumption, right? In particular, your examples may be correlated with each other, and there are different set of techniques, right, which sort of need to be used, and I guess the learnability question becomes more difficult there, right, in terms of, you know, how well you would generalize, because the examples may be correlated, but that's not really the subject that we'll deal here, right? We'll sort of assume that xi yi are iid, and right, and given that right, and also the fact that xy comes from the same underlying distribution, right, we would like to understand the behavior of our learned hypothesis on you know, future examples, right, which are coming from the same distribution. Okay, the second assumption that we make here is about, you know, what we refer to as inductive bias, right, and for that, right, for that, you know, let us go back to our sort of right, this learning a line example, right, this was our y and this was our x, right, and we were trying to really fit a line onto this data, right? And maybe this gives you a good fit, right? So, but now the question is, right, why would you believe that a line is a good hypothesis space, right? Or linear hypothesis is a good space, right? So maybe, right, so what we have done here is we have picked the best line, right? Best sort of linear hypothesis, right? Among the set of all possible linear hypotheses, right? And then you have taken the one that fits the training data well. But the question is, right, why not choose, you know, something like a quadratic hypothesis space, right? And clearly, right, that will fit as well, at least as well as the linear hypothesis, right? Or maybe, you know, why not choose, you know, a polynomial hypothesis space, right? Which again is a generalization of the quadratic hypothesis space, right? Which is actually a superset, right? If you take sort of arbitrary or higher degree polynomials, right? And then the question is, right, because these are sort of strict supersets of each other, right? Then clearly on the training data, right, if you choose a hypothesis from the polynomial hypothesis, it is bound to do at least as well, right? And which means the training error would be better minimized, right? Or at least as well minimized using a larger hypothesis space, right? Then the question is, you know, why not use larger hypothesis space and obtain a better training error or lesser training error, right? But as we saw earlier, right, intuitively that this is not always sort of the best thing to do, because it might lead to overfitting, right? And remember what was overfitting. Overfitting was saying that although you may fit very well the patterns in the data, but you may not generalize because you are fitting patterns in the data which are sort of you know representing noise, right? And that's where we said, you know, there is a trade-off between learning using simpler hypothesis space, which is a linear hypothesis space in this case, versus sort of, you know, more complicated or polynomial hypothesis space. Right? And there is and then also that if you can fit your data well, right, using a simpler hypothesis, then maybe that's what you will prefer then, because it is you know likely to generalize well. And that's where this assumption comes in, right, about, you know, one of the fundamental assumptions you know made in machine learning, right, which is also sort of your inductive bias, right, or which is sort of the fact that you are biasing your preference for hypotheses which are simpler than more complicated if both of them fit your data, you know, more or less to equal extent, right? And this is what is referred to as Occam's razor, that you know given you know different sort of hypothesis, right? If your data can be explained better by something which is simpler, you know, and one has to formally define what is the notion of simplicity, but in this case it could be you know in terms of right, for finite hypothesis it could be the size of the finite hypothesis classes, it could be the size of the hypothesis spaces, right? For example, decision trees, right, over discrete spaces, but we will also look at the notions of you know the size, quote unquote, of infinite dimensional hypothesis spaces, and that will lead us to something called VC dimension, but that's later. But you know, even in this case of regression, right, we understand that the set of lines is a strict subset of you know set of all polynomials, right? So in that sense, you know, lines are sort of simpler hypothesis, right? And what we are saying here is that if you can fit your data well using a line, then you may not want to go to a more complicated polynomial, and that is the principle of Occam's razor, right? And remember that is also reflected, for example, if you go back to decision trees, then we preferred, you know, smaller decision trees, and we grew them, right? You know, as right, we right minimize the training error, and then we sort of stopped at a point because you know after that it might lead to overfit. Similarly, right, in neural networks, I talked briefly about, you know, starting right with weights zero, right, or you start with the small weights, right, which again represent your simplicity of hypothesis space, and you make it more complicated, right? Or in other way, right, a simpler neural network will be one with less number of you know layers, and that is less likely to overfit, right? So if you can really do well on the training data with a smaller network, then that probably is a better choice than a more complicated network because it might overfit, right? And this is sort of the inductive bias assumption, right? Or inductive bias that is happening in all these cases that that we typically make in machine learning, right? And this sort of inductive bias will also be useful for generalizability results, and we will see that you know, your generalizability also depends on sort of your size of hypothesis space, right? Larger the hypothesis space, right, harder it is, right, for you to prove that it sort of generalizes well, right? And we will see that sort of exact connection in next few slides. Okay. So the third thing that will really sort of worry about is number of examples, right? So let us take the previous sort of slide again, right? This linear regression example, this is y and this is x, right? And right, this is our line, right? And right, suppose we learn this line on bunch of data points I equal to 1 to m, right? And right, we'll see that this number of examples is also a very important factor in terms of, you know, how well you can generalize, right? In particular, you know, assume that, you know, you learn this hypothesis using, let's say, m equal to 100 examples. Now the question is, right, suppose a new point comes in and you compute h theta x, where theta is your learned parameters by optimizing over error over training data, and then you predict y hat, right? And now the question is, right, what is your sort of confidence in you know, how good this y hat is an estimate of your actual prediction or actual label, which is y, right? So you have your model outputs y hat on unseen example, but your actual label is y, and then how strongly you believe that y hat is close to y, right? This is an important question, right, from a right, not just from a theoretical point of view, but also a practical standpoint of view, right? What is your confidence in sort of your error on your unseen examples, and we'll see that this critically depends on number of examples that were used for learning your hypothesis. For example, right, suppose m was only 2, right? So if you used only 2 examples in the above case, then what will happen is your confidence in generalizability will be very low, right? Given 2 examples, it is very hard to sort of learn a good fit, right? And suppose m was, let's say, 1,000,000, then your confidence suddenly will increase quite a bit, right? Because you have a large number of examples, and your confidence of your prediction on feature data will increase, right? So this is sort of the third factor that we'll talk about, in terms of generalizability, right? So what we have done here is we have talked about 3 sort of different dimensions or assumptions, if you will, maybe dimension is a better word, right? So one is about IID assumption, right? That your data is independently identically distributed, the training and the test examples, right, come from the same distribution, right? Each example, right, in the training set comes from the same distribution from which your test examples will also be drawn, right? One. Second, there is some kind of inductive bias, right? Inductive assumption that we are making that, you know, maybe simpler hypotheses generalize well, right? Or rather, right, the way we will look at it in our exposition is that our results will sort of general will depend on the size of hypothesis space, and we'll see that the guarantees that we'll get will be sort of inversely proportional to the size of hypothesis space, right? Because, you know, larger hypothesis classes are more likely to overfit, and the last thing we'll see that our sort of results, right, generalizability guarantees will also depend on number of examples, and there'll be sort of a more direct relationship, right, that more number of examples that we learn over, right, or over or optimize over, right, better generalizability will get on feature data, right? So this is sort of the broad intuition of what we are sort of going to do. Okay, so finally, right, I want to stress that, or I want to make a point that whatever we have described sort of on the previous slide, right, or previous few slides, we have described in terms of regression, but exactly the same set of ideas or same set of principles also apply for the task of classification, right? So just recall our sort of, you know, standard examples of monkeys and chimpanzees, right? So maybe these are chimps on the right side of this line, and these are monkeys, right? The negative ones, and this is our the feature height, and this is our feature weight, right? And let's say we are trying to learn a linear classifier, right? So this is our training data, right? So now we have xi, yi, I equal to 1 to m, right? And each yi now belongs to just 0 and 1, right? Where 0 is the monkey's class and 1 is the chimpanzee class, right? So now, given this, right, you could ask exactly the same set of questions, right? The sort of question that we asked, right? One is about, you know, whether your test example, right, feature test example, is it coming from the same sort of underlying distribution, right? So not only, right, each of your training examples come from some underlying distribution, right? And we sort of assume that they are IID, but to generalize well, right, we have to be able to be convinced that, you know, future example, right, or future test example, which where only height and weight will be given, will also follow the same kind of distribution. Only then you can actually classify it well using your learned hypothesis, right, which will be, in this case, will be essentially indicator of h theta x is, let's say, greater than or equal to 0.5, right? So this will be your final hypothesis, right? And for you to be able to classify it well, right, your test example has to come from the same distribution from which training examples came from. The second is about, you know, what is a good hypothesis class, right? So again, right, given that we can separate the data well using a linear hypothesis or linear separator, right, we may not want to go to more complicated functions, right? So there is sort of an underlying assumption or inductive bias that we'll prefer simpler hypothesis here, right? And that will be, as I said, reflected in the fact that generalizability sort of will be inversely proportional to the size of your hypothesis space, and later on we'll characterize this size in terms of even for infinite dimensional hypothesis spaces, like in this case, right? And then finally, it's also about number of examples, right? How many examples did you see, right, to really learn your hypothesis? And larger the number of examples that you saw, right, better or more stronger your confidence will be in generalization, right? So once again, right, we'll make the assumption that training and test data come from the same distribution. We'll show the dependence on the size of the hypothesis, and we'll see that you know, simpler the hypothesis, right, more better generalizability you get. Assuming, of course, that, you know, your training error, right, your simpler hypothesis can achieve a reasonable or similar training error as a more complicated hypothesis. And finally, right, we will have more confidence in generalizability if we use a larger number of examples while training, right? So larger is the number of examples while training, right, more confidence you have in terms of generalization. Okay, so let me make a few more remarks about the setting that we will operate in, right, for you know, this topic on learning theory. So the first is that we will deal with classification tasks, right, and that to sort of binary classification tasks, right? So in particular, we will assume that, you know, we have these bunch of examples, right, I, xi, I equal to 1 to m, and each of these yi, right, will belong to the set 0 or 1, right? So these are simply, you know, binary classification tasks that we'll deal with. Right, so what we'll also assume that it's already written here is that we'll assume that we are given a fixed number of examples, which is, you know, m, right? So we'll assume that we have a certain number of examples which is given by this m, and then we'll of course see the dependence of our results on m, right? And xi could in general be sort of in Rn, right? So that's not a problem for us, but we'll assume that yi is or xi could also be sort of discrete valued, right? That's not an issue. But yi will be assumed to be belonging to this 0-1 class, right? For the result that we see here. And then what we will do is we will define two quantities. So one is epsilon hat h, right, which is over right. So in fact, before this before I write this, there is another sort of assumption, right, or another important quantity which will be our hypothesis. We'll assume that our hypotheses are coming from, you know, this curly H, right, which is the set of all possible hypotheses that we can hypothesis class, right, that we can learn from, right. And in the beginning few lectures, I guess this lecture and maybe the next one, we'll assume that H is finite dimensional, right? H is a finite size hypothesis, right? So we'll assume that H is finite sized, and of course, right, this is very restrictive assumption. We'll generalize it later to infinite dimensional hypothesis, right? And then the fourth one is again sort of a notation or important for an important quantity that we'll use is epsilon hat H, right? So this epsilon hat H will be used to specify our training error for a particular hypothesis, right? So given an H belonging to this curly H, right, our training error is simply those set of examples in the training set where HXI, remember HXI is now just 0 or 1, right, is not equal to YI, and sum over all possible examples divided by M. Right, so this will be this epsilon hat H will be the notion of our training error, and we'll also define what is referred to as epsilon H or generalization error, which will simply be if I draw an example from an underlying distribution, right? I should have mentioned that, right, which is sort of the zero assumption, is that we'll assume that all our examples are coming from some underlying distribution, right, all training examples, right, and also our test examples are coming from the same distribution, right? So this is the setting that we're describing, right, that our training data is IID and test data also comes from the same distribution, and then we are dealing with, you know, binary classification tasks. We are given a specific number of examples, M examples. We have a hypothesis class from which we can learn, and this is our training error for a particular hypothesis in that hypothesis class. And finally, right, this epsilon H is our generalization error, which is simply, you know, the expected value of this quantity, which is y not equal to hx, right? So this is the generalization error of hypothesis H, right? This is simply saying that, you know, if I randomly draw an example xi, right, test example from this distribution, right, what is sort of the expected value of this quantity, right? That should have been an indicator, right? So this is the expected value of, right, if I randomly draw an example, right, what is my expectation that my hypothesis will make the correct prediction on this example, and the expected value of this over all examples is my generalization error. Finally, right, to give a preview of what is going to come, we'll be interested in understanding how good of a predictor is epsilon hat h of our generalization error, right? So what we have control over, or rather what we know of, is epsilon hat h, and in fact we have some control over it because we can find a hypothesis which minimizes this, right? But the question is, you know, how good of this is a predictor of our generalization error, which what we really care about, and as I said, we will do this in the context of, you know, simple binary classification tasks, and initially we will start with finite size hypothesis, but we'll generalize it to infinite dimensional hypothesis spaces also. I think let me stop here and we'll continue in the next class. Thanks.